I am weary from the waves crashing over every day. God of mercy, please come rescue me. I am longing for your voice, your gentle whisper. Tell me everything's alright. Yeah. Your power, your presence breaks strongholds. King of heaven, when you speak, mountains move. I believe there will be breakthrough.
Welcome to Citrus Park Online. We're so glad you could join us. Would you worship with us in this time?
Praise Him. Oh, praise
something for you now. It comes from a devotional from our favorite worship leaders, Shane and Shane. And he's talking about David and in Psalm 51. When we first hear and receive this good news of Jesus Christ, we're quite content to have our sins forgiven and our shame removed. We feel the heavy burden being lifted of all we've done wrong, and even sense the consequences of offending an all-knowing and all-powerful God. In one sense, we know there's still work to do, a lingering sense of our remaining sin, but the relief of simply being forgiven is even more powerful. But what if Jesus died for more than forgiveness? The good news of the gospel doesn't stop with pardon. We treat grace like it's God's big eraser for our every wrong or mistake. But God does not only mean to rub the page clean. No, he intends to write a new story in sin's place, replacing what was once broken, wicked, and dead with love, faithfulness, and life. The gospel doesn't just get us out of hell. It also makes us new. Grace doesn't just help us shed the weight of past sins. It empowers us to feel and live differently. Heavenly Father, now we just want to thank you and praise you for the abundant grace that you pour out on us. In the darkest, most ugly time of our life, Lord, you've loved us the same as when we are walking right alongside you and we're praying and we're reading your word. Lord, your love for us doesn't change. It doesn't waver. It doesn't depend on how well we are acting, how well we are living out this Christian life. Or do you want to replace our sin? You want to take our sin? You want to take our burdens, but not just for sake of wiping the slate clean again, because we're going to mess it up again and again and again. Lord, you're wanting to rewrite a story. Take our path and turn it completely. Have us go the direction that you're calling us to in our life. And your grace covers that. Lord, now would you encourage my brothers and sisters with that reminder that your grace is exceedingly far above any wrong, any mistake, any act that we could ever do. There's nothing so big that you would stop loving us or that your grace would run dry. May you be exalted in this time of worship. In your name we pray. Grace, what have you done? Murder for me on that cross. Accused in absence of wrong. My sin washed away in your blood. Too much to make sense of it all. I know that your love breaks my fall. A scandal of grace, you died in my place, so my soul will live. Oh, to be like you, to give all I have just to know you. Jesus, there's no one beside. Oh, to be loved.
Good morning, Citrus Park family. Good morning. Welcome to worship service online. Turn in your Bibles to 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 1 through 8. That's 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 1 through 8. This is a Christian Standard Bible. And I want to just remind you of where we were at last week. Paul was very concerned about the faith of the Thessalonians. And he said, I really live. I'm celebrating if I know that you are walking in faith with the Lord Jesus Christ. If you're not, he had great fear. His words were of great concern. So he had a very high and a very low, depending upon how he felt their faith was. And he got the report back from Timothy that they were walking with God. And he made the statement, he says, now I really live, knowing that you are firm, standing firm in the Lord Jesus. Now, in light of that, it says here in verse 1, look at what it says. Additionally then, in light of that, now add to that this topic, brothers and sisters. Now, we've hit this pretty hard. We've made a great big deal about brothers and sisters. In the past, throughout this book and up until this point, we've said brothers and sisters has to do with the Thessalonians speaking out about the person of Jesus Christ. Brothers and sisters has to do with the persecution received from speaking about Jesus Christ. But also, their imitation of Paul and Timothy and the others that were in Christ had to do with not just what they were doing and what they were saying, but what they were not doing as well too. And that's what this topic addresses as we begin here in verses 1 and 2. Brothers and sisters pertains to, in this particular section, what they are not doing, what they are not involved in, which is extremely admirable in light of the society that they were in. It goes on to say, we ask and encourage you in the Lord Jesus, very important, we're going to address that as you have received instruction from us, on how you should live and please God as you are doing, do this even more. That's important as well, too. It's going to come up later on in this particular flow of Scripture in this chapter when it addresses brotherly love. He's going to say the same thing. As you are doing, do this even more. This is amazing in light of the topic we're going to talk about, that they are walking with God in this particular area in light of where they're living and the setting that they are in at that time as well, too. And he says, this is my encouragement, do this even more. Verse 2. For you know what commands we gave you through the Lord Jesus. That's important as well, too. I feel like that has to do with Timothy in the last chapter. And then he says commands, and he's talking about what pleases the Lord Jesus in verse 1. And now he jumps to verse 3 with a similar theme. For this is God's will. What pleases God? And for this is God's will, your sanctification. Whenever I think of God's will and your sanctification, I jump to Romans chapter 12 and verse 1 and 2. I was privileged and I was honored to grow up in a family that loved the Lord, that gave me an example. I've spoken to that before. I never had to memorize this passage. There's certain passages in the Bible that I encourage you to make as foundational passages of your life. Romans 12, 1 and 2 is one of them. I never had to memorize this. My dad preached on this so many times that I knew this without even have to work on memorization. It says here in verse 1, it says this, I beseech you, I urge you, I beg you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. And here he's saying, look, your sanctification is by being a living sacrifice. Sanctification and holiness simply mean one thing. You are set apart for what God would have you do in this particular area that we're about to talk about. Sanctification can be in a lot of different areas. He says, no, look, the world lives this way. You used to live this way. You are in the Lord Jesus. And now I want you to live this other way. I want you to be set apart to please God and to do God's will in this area. Getting back to verse 1, Mercy, if you can jump back there. In verse 1, he makes a statement. He says, in the Lord Jesus. I want to remind you, this is foundational for the book of 1 Thessalonians. Very important. He says, in order to be in the Lord Jesus, we've got to go over it again. This speaks to your position and the fact that God the Father chose you in eternity past. So where's your salvation and what does it depend on? Does it depend on you? It doesn't. It depends on the fact that God the Father chose you in time past. What the Lord Jesus had to do was the second part, through Jesus' death, and it was for sin, and then we said several weeks ago, it was unto sin, and that's very powerful. I can live my life through the power of God because Christ died unto sin. I don't have to just do what my nature or what the world says around me. God died unto sin, to sin, so I don't have to participate in these things. But lastly, and very important for this text as well, is the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. And here we receive that at faith. This is why we are in the Lord Jesus, and this is very important to this section of Scripture. We are in God. We are in the Lord Jesus. We are part of His family, brothers and sisters. Goes on to say here in verse 2, that we deliver this message to you through the Lord Jesus. I believe also Timothy last week was sent to the Thessalonians by the ambassadorship that Paul gave him, but also he encouraged them and strengthened them, it said in the text, and from the inference from the passages, he did it through the Lord Jesus and through his power. These are not just words we use and we talk about as trite words that we say amongst each other. Verses 1 and 2 are foundational because of the topic we're going to deal with. And here he says, for this is God's will. And we spoke about Romans chapter 12 and verse 1. It speaks to the fact that we're to be living sacrifices. Do you have Romans up there, Merce? Verse 2. Guess what? Verse 2 says this. Well, how does it all work? this sacrifice thing, this being separate, this being apart unto what God would have us to do. It begins in the mind. Verse 2. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of what? Your mind. Then, that, and for the purpose that you may prove what is that good, acceptable, and perfect will of God. So whenever we talk about God's will and we talk about sanctification, listen, Romans 12, 1 and 2, extremely important. Get that into your memory. This is what God is calling us to do. Very important, the first two verses as well as the beginning here of chapter 3. Very important. In light of what? In light of the number one sin that had to do with the Roman community. And that sin is sexual immorality. Listen to what he says here. That you keep away from sexual immorality. That you avoid, abstain, keep away from it. Sanctify yourself, separated, apart from sexual immorality. Sexual immorality can be defined as sex outside of marriage. Any sex outside of marriage, sex in the mind outside of marriage, you know, fantasies, all of those things. And it encompasses so many different things. It can go from all the way from bestiality, homosexuality, fornication, adultery. All of those things are sexual immorality. But as we saw in Romans 12, where does it begin? Verse 2, in the mind. Don't be conformed to this world, but be transformed in the mind. And here he says, listen, first and foremost, I want you to be set apart. I want you to be different. I don't want you to look like the world. Well, I said in the beginning that verses 1 and 2 were very foundational for a reason. And they were. What was the reason? Because number one, of the families that these people were born into. And I made this quote. I was really proud of it. It says this. It's very hard to break a sin stronghold when you've watched your parents, your extended family, indulge in this particular sin from your earliest recollection. Very important. That's why he says, listen, you're in the Lord Jesus. You're not a part of this Gentile family that lived a certain way. You've been separated unto God for this purpose. And remember I said sex outside of marriage. And I think it's important that I address to you as well too, that sex is not wrong. God makes, he says, listen, I have a beautiful place for sex. It's within the bonds of marriage. And he says the marriage bed is undefiled in Hebrews chapter 13, 5. Yet, he also gives us encouragement in the Song of Solomon. He says this, do not arouse passions before their rightful time. God says, look, I'm not saying it's wrong. It would be cruel of God to give us an appetite and a desire for thirst and not allow us to participate in that. Back in the 70s, it was quoted by one preacher that Hugh Hefner had said that the sexual appetite needs to be encouraged in all different areas, whether it's sexual immorality or not, to the point where if you don't encourage it and participate in it, you're going to end up with neuroses and mental illness. And God says, no, that's not true at all. I have a plan for it, and it's in its proper place, and it's in its proper time. But what was the Roman society up against? First and foremost, this was a generational sin that had been handed down family after family. Kids were ingrained in it. It was like the sin from Exodus. It says the sins of the fathers are passed on to the third and to the fourth generation. Another statement I wanted to make too about the society at that time, it says this. This society's primary, fully sanctioned industry, completely condoned and completely encouraged, was sexual immorality. And this is important. With no thought of ever receiving any repercussion from it at all. Can you imagine that? Can you imagine a society where anything goes? That's where they were raised. That's why Paul said, I want you to know, you're part of the Lord's family. You are a brother and sister in Christ. Do you want to please God in light of that? Well, there's going to be some hard issues that you have to go up against. And one has to do with the way that your family raised you, the things you saw as a child. I'll never forget, as a child being 8 years old, nine, somewhere in there, I was in a department store, and we were in line, we were about ready to pay for the stuff. And it was Zayer's department store. It's an old one. And I was standing in line, and I looked over, and there was this lady who was basically wearing a bikini. Now, listen, on the beach, you go to prepare yourself. If you go to the beach, you're called to do that type of thing. Then you're going to prepare yourself for what you're going to see. This was like, I'm an 8-year-old. Everybody else is fully dressed. And here she is, almost naked. And I looked at my dad. I'm pulling on him. I'm like, Dad, look at that. Dad, you know, I'm just a natural kid, right? And my father would not look. He looked straight ahead. He didn't address me with it. He just, by his behavior and what he didn't do, gave me an example of what sanctification is all about, being separated unto God to this other way of life. I was like, why wouldn't you look at something like that? Because of this right here. He says, look, my dad's desire, my mom's as well, was to please God. But not only that, they knew God's will for their lives. And they said, look, we have given this area of our life. I had an example of what was positive. I cannot imagine growing up in the Roman society with families that are like this, fully indulging from my earliest recollection. Could you imagine that? I was so blessed to have the opposite. But here, the society's primary, fully sanctioned industry was sexual immorality, completely condoned. This society had prostitutes, and they had all different types of prostitutes, and it was a separate industry. But not only that, the Roman society also had prostitution within religious groups. You could go to a church, so to speak, and participate in sex of any kind, fully condoned, and it was seen as completely acceptable. So we had prostitutes, and then we had temple prostitutes. But it doesn't stop there. This society encouraged misters and mistresses. You got to have yourself a mistress as well as a wife. And this was completely condoned, completely natural, but doesn't stop there. They had fully sanctioned slavery. So to purchase a woman for the complete purpose to be a concubine is a sex slave trade that was going on, fully sanctioned by society at that time. On top of those things, you were encouraged to have intellectual friendships and relationships. And oh yeah, by the way, curry sexual favors with them as well too. That's what I mean when I say fully sanctioned, completely condoned, never receiving repercussion. That's where they were raised. This is where this church was founded, in the midst of all this. So when God comes along and says, listen, in order to please me, I need you to be separate from it. It was this radical message. That's why he laid the groundwork and said, listen, you are in the Lord. You are separate to live separately in your thoughts, in your actions, to look different than the rest of the world. He goes on to describe here in verse 4. He says this, that each of you knows how to control his own body in holiness. Holiness is the same word as sanctification, basically, and it means to be set apart for God's purpose in this particular area. Can you trust God with this area of your life? Can you allow yourself to be a sacrifice in this area of your life? Oh yeah, as I was going through the Roman society, I missed one group. There's the wives and the husbands. The wife's job in this society was to take care of the home and to have children in spite of all this stuff going on. Isn't it amazing? It's amazing, this society. It blows my mind. It's, you know, in a lot of ways, we are different from that particular society. But yet, the availability, as I talked about it last week, the pornography consumption that's going on during this particular time of the coronavirus, what I'm hearing is unprecedented. God says, listen, there's another way to live. There's a way in which I can satisfy those needs and those desires. Folks, when it comes to this, we have gotten it all wrong in so many different ways. One of the things that breaks my heart is that in this society, there are people coming into the church who they don't understand that living together is wrong. They don't understand what the church needs to catch up to this generation. No, that's not the case. What is it called? It's called fornication. It's called immorality. And God cannot bless that particular situation. And he says, listen, I've called you to another way of life. I've called you to trust me with this area of life. There's a time and a place for it, and it's within the bonds of marriage. Hebrews chapter 13 says the marriage bed is undefiled. God is not this, he's not this great Scrooge in the sky saying, I'm going to give you this appetite, and then I'm not going to give you an outlet. I'm going to make you suffer. No, he says, I have a perfect plan for this area. And I want you to walk in holiness and in honor. Verse 5 goes on to say this, not with lustful passions like the Gentiles. This is very important. Who don't know God. What's he saying through the text? He's saying, you guys do know God. You do have this relationship in the Lord Jesus Christ with him. You are different from the world. They're going to act different. They don't know God. There's something that happened to you when you were in Christ. God called you away. He changed your desires. And it was amazing to me. Paul and Timothy probably spent about, I don't know, a year and a half with the Thessalonians, and then Paul was gone for several months, and then he sent Timothy back. But these people, after a lifetime of being in this environment, being raised the way they were, it said in the beginning, as you are doing, do this even more. It's amazing to me the power of the Word of God and the Holy Spirit in their life to completely transform them. It says, listen, verse 6, this means one must not transgress against and take advantage of his brothers and sisters in this matter. And what he's saying here is, look, it doesn't need to be in the church. It does not need to be in the church because, and here's the reason why, because the Lord is an avenger of all these offenses, as we also previously told you and warned you about. And it's important when we, once again, here we go. Okay, Dave. You're talking about judgment again, so you're probably just trying to be mean in the area of sex. You're probably just trying to make us afraid for no reason in the area of sex. No. The reason I'm talking about it, the reason I'm bringing up the topic of living together is because it's wrong, and this is truth. It's God's truth. It's what he has designed that you understand and know about this totally different way of life that God wants you to live. And here he says, listen, there are consequences for living this way. I always, you know, it's funny, I was thinking about this and I looked up, and as I was going through the section, I saw that another comment, Warren Wiersbe, was thinking the same way. I was thinking about this particular area, and all of us do. We go here because it's the biggest one, right? It's David and his sin with Bathsheba when it comes to immorality. When it comes to judgment, it says here in 2 Samuel chapter 12 and verse 10, it says that Nathan the prophet said the sword would never depart from David's house. This was fulfilled in a successive violent deaths of at least three of his sons, Amnon, Absalom, which the youth talked about on Wednesday night, and Adonijah. All three of his sons were killed. The sword would never, the second punishment that God put on David for sexual sin was this, that prophet Nathan, he prophesied to David that his wives would be humiliated before all of Israel. This also was fulfilled when Absalom laid with his father's wives in the sight of all Israel. The third punishment Nathan pronounced was the fatal end of the son conceived by David. David's sin with Bathsheba. This was fulfilled 7 days afterwards. Listen, folks, I just don't want to be a killjoy in this area. I'm not trying to be mean or make you afraid. I'm trying to say, listen, there's consequences. If you want certain things in life, God says, listen, there's a relationship I want to have with you first. I want you to understand that I am the love of your life. I can take care of these other areas of your life. If you sanctify yourself, set apart this area, make this part a living sacrifice to me. And look, you're going to have to not be conformed. to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. There is a way in which I want you to live and I want you to be blessed. And the only reason I bring up that God is an avenger is because it's true. It happens. I want this to be something that you avoid in your life. Verse 7 goes on and says this, "For God has not called us to impurity, but to live in," what are we talking about? "Separated unto God in this holiness." That's what it means, holiness. Holiness unto God. Verse 8 says this, "Consequently, anyone who rejects this does not reject man, but God, who gives you His Holy Spirit." And that's the last thing that we talked about when we talked about being in the Lord Jesus Christ. We talked about the Holy Spirit. When I think about impurity and the Holy Spirit, I think about 1 Corinthians chapter 6 and verse 19 that addresses this topic. It says this, "Don't you know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit, which you have from God? You were bought with a price." And just so you know, that particular area doesn't have to do with drugs and alcohol, though those are bad when we allow those things to control our life. It doesn't have to do with overeating and potato chips and ice cream. Your body's the temple, right? What it has to do is sexual impurity. It says in that section, why would you be joined with a prostitute? He has given you the Holy Spirit who is within you to be joined with Him. He says, look, He's going to guide you in what is right, but your body is a temple. All other sins, it says in 1 Corinthians 6, are done outside of the body. Sexual sin is one that is extremely intimate and personal. And here He says, look, I've given you the Holy Spirit who can take care of you and who can lead you in all of these things and all of these areas. I want you to know that one of the reasons I know that Jesus is alive is because He can give you victory in this area. He can give you purity and allow this area of your life to be set apart to Him. When I was a baby Christian, I was learning what it meant to walk with the Lord. And several weeks ago, I gave you 1 Corinthians chapter 10 and verse 13. And in that section, it says this. It says, there's no temptation, there's no trial taking you, but what is common to man. But God is faithful. For me, in the area of sexual purity, I would quote this over and over to Him. He won't allow you to be tempted above that you're able. But He will, with the temptation, make a way of escape. Christ came as our way of escape for punishment for sin. But Christ comes whenever we say, Lord, I don't want to fall into this because I know that there's sorrow. I know that there's penalties in this area. I know that Your way is best. And Lord, if I give into this, I'm going to give in to shame and sorrow. My mind is where it starts first. And I would say, Lord, it says in the text, but You are faithful. You won't allow me to be tested above that I am able, but You will, with the temptation, make a way of escape. Jesus, this is what we've been talking about in this passage. I believe You're right here with me. I'm going to hold Your hand. I'm going to walk with You. I'm going to trust You with this area of my life. But listen, Lord, if I trust You with this area of my life, I'm going to ask that You keep Your word and You allow this area of my life to be a blessing, not just to myself, but others as well too, because You are faithful, because You can sanctify, You can set me apart. And Lord, I want You to be alive in this area. Lord, give me that area, that way of escape, so that I may be. Lord, Your word says You are faithful. You won't allow me to be tested above that I'm able. God calls us to this very different way of life. This society was rife with immorality. It was unique. It was even worse than today. And God had a group of people that He was raising up that were part of His family now. And what amazes me is the section that He gave me, just the few words, I think it's 8 words here. It says, as you are doing, do this even more. As you are doing, do this even more. I want you to just come to a time of prayer where you pray over your family and those that are given in to this area of their life. Maybe it's even you. And I want you to come to the Lord and admit, Lord, Your way is the best way. I want you just to say to Him, Lord, I know that this area of so-and-so's life or my life is wrong. And Lord, I need the strength to act like a brother and sister, to act like a child of God. Lord, I need the ability to turn away from the sin and to turn to You. Just tell Him that. Just speak to Him today. Listen, He's forgiving. He can transform your life and make you a testimony. The world doesn't know how to take this when they hear somebody sanctified and wholly separate from this. They can't understand it, but it is an incredible testimony of what God is able to do in your life. He can make this place a place of blessing for you. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, I thank You and I praise You for Your goodness in this area. I thank You, Lord, that You are faithful. I thank You, Lord, that we can trust You in the most important areas of our life. I thank You that You have given a testimony, Lord, of those that You have changed in the past. I thank You, Lord, that we can look at this and say it's possible. It can happen in my life. Lord, thank You for the hope that You give in this area. Lord, we pray for those who are struggling in this area to find You and to make their lives a sacrifice to You in this area. Lord, we thank You and praise You in Jesus' name. Amen.
Rich in love, He is good to all.